Let's start the session today. In fact, in the last session, we have started discussing entity relationship model. And today we are going to continue the same discussion with respect to few more concepts. In the last session, we have gone through the concepts like entity. We have seen what we mean by attributes. Also, we have gone through the concept of entity set. So, entity is an object that exists, and entity is a thing that can be distinguished from another thing. Attributes are the characteristics, those describe the entities. Entity sets are the collection of entities. So we have seen those concepts in the last session. We have seen the examples also. We have seen what we mean by attribute. So it is actually describing the properties of the entity sets. We also have gone through the concept of domain. So domain is the set of permitted values for each attribute, and we have seen actually what we mean by domain with one example. So let me once again give the example to understand what we mean by domain. So if, let us assume that if we are having the entity set that is instructor and one of the attributes say ID. So let us assume that ID is the attribute of type character, right? And let us assume that the size of this attribute ID is say 5 characters. So meaning the ID can be maximum at the max having the 5 characters. So what we mean by a domain now? As I mentioned earlier, it is the set of permitted values for each attribute. Now, the attribute is described like it is having the type character, and the width or size of that attribute is 5. So what we mean by that, the values, those we may have for that ID is the set of values having any combination of 5 characters. I'll repeat. What is the set of values those we may have for ID? I may say that any set of characters, right, having the width of 5. So any set of 5 characters, any combination of 5 characters can be the value for ID. So that is the set of permitted values, and that is how we define the domain. I have mentioned one more example also in the last session. If I am having the numeric attribute, and if I say that my attribute is of type integer, right, and having 2 digits, then I may say that the set of permitted values are from 0, 1 till 99, right? So those are the permitted values. So that is what we say as the domain. So every attribute is associated with certain domain. So every attribute is actually, we have seen domain constraint also. So whenever we associate the type of that attribute along with the specification, then actually we are putting the domain constraint for that attribute. So we are allowing some set of values to be assigned as the value for that attribute. I hope the concept is clear. If you have any doubt, please let me know. Yes, roll number 304. Are you there? Rahul, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
So whether you have understood the concept of domain?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So let's proceed now with the next concept. So now we are going to discuss about the types of attributes. So we know now what is the attribute. Attribute is actually describing the properties of entity sets, right? In its basic sense. So we are having several types of attributes. So what are those types of attributes? We may have simple attributes or we may have composite attributes. So what we mean by a simple attribute and what we mean by a composite attribute? Simple attribute is the attribute that cannot be divided in subparts. I'll repeat. Simple attribute is attribute that cannot be divided into subparts. Whereas composite attribute is an attribute that has been divided or that can be divided into subparts. Let me give you one example what I mean. So here on your screen, you are visualizing few attributes. So if I'm having name as the attribute, right? Say for example, in my instructor entity set, if I want to store the name of the instructor, then instead of having a simple attribute, I may come up with the composite attribute. And if I'm having this composite attribute, how I'm going to describe that attribute? I'm having now the subparts of this name. So what are those subparts? I'll be having first name, I'll be having middle initial name or the last name. So these are three parts of my attribute name, right? So while designing, if I use such kind of mechanism to divide my attribute in subparts, then I say that this attribute name is my composite attribute because it has been divided into three parts: first name, middle initial, and last name. Similarly, if we want to store the address, then it is a good idea that you should use address as the composite attribute, having some subparts. So what are the subparts here? Address can be divided as street, city, state, and postal code, right? So if address is divided into subparts, I may say that address is my composite attribute. Similarly, if you look at this particular figure, street is subpart of composite attribute address, but I may treat this attribute street as once again the composite attribute. So once again, the street can further be divided into three components: street number, street name, apartment number, whatever it may be, right? So this is how we are making use of the composite attributes to, you may say that we are grouping some related data under that composite attribute. So composite attribute can be divided into subparts, and its individual subparts can further be divided. And we are making use of such kind of a design to simplify our modeling of data, right? Many times, instead of having a simple attribute, we go with the composite attributes. And the reason is to make our design more suitable for handling the data, for retrieving the data. For example, let me give you one example. If I declare name as the composite attribute with three subparts, first name, middle initial, and last name, and afterwards, after building it practically, say for example, if I want to search the names based on last name, then as last name is a subcomponent of name, it would be possible for me to search my data based on this last name. If it happens that I am storing all these three components in a simple attribute, in one attribute, then what will happen? Many times my users are not aware how actually to input the data. So somebody may input first name initially, somebody may input last name initially. So it would be very difficult for me to search the data according to say first name or last name or something like that. Similar is the case for address. If everything I'm putting together in only one field, one attribute, then what will happen? Simple attribute. What will happen if I would like to search according to city of a person, or if I want to search according to the postal code, then it may not be possible for me because everything is put together in one attribute. Instead, what we can do is we may make use of the composite attributes and we may divide the attributes in subparts so that it would be convenient to model also, and later on whenever we go with implementation, it would be more effective as far as storing the data and retrieval of data is considered, right? So I'll repeat once again the definitions for both kinds of attributes, simple and composite. Simple attributes are the attributes those are not being divided into subparts, whereas composite attributes are the attributes those can be divided into subparts. I hope you might have understood the concept. If you have any doubts, please let me know. Any doubts? May I proceed? May I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So let's go to the next type of attributes, and that is single valued attribute and multi-valued attributes. So what we mean by single valued attribute? The single valued attribute is actually storing only one value, only one value, right? For example, if I talk about ID of the student, ID of the student. So obviously ID of the student is only one value, it is a single value. So ID is the attribute that is single value because it is storing a single value, right? And many of the attributes that we use are the single valued attributes. But sometimes we need to make use of multi-valued attributes. Those are storing multiple values. So what we mean by that? Say for example, phone number is one of the attributes. It may happen that one person is using more than one phone numbers. In that situation, we are declaring this attribute phone number as multi-valued attribute, or in ER diagram will show phone number as the multi-valued attribute. How actually pictorially or diagrammatically denote that, we are going to look at it a bit later. But let us just understand the meanings of these several terms, right? So single valued attribute always stores a single value, whereas multi-valued attributes may store 0, 1 or many values, right? The example, typical example may be phone number. One person may have more than one phone numbers, So we may treat this phone number as the multi-valued attribute. Or email ID. We may have more than one email IDs. So we may treat this email ID as multi-valued attribute. Right? But the ID of the student would be single value, because one person is having only one ID and that is a single value. Right? Name of the student, provided we are not making use of the nicknames, every person is having only one name. Right? Salary of the instructor, every person is having a single amount that is treated as salary. So these are the single valued attributes. Whereas, what we mean by multi-valued attribute? An attribute that is having more than one value, including zero. It may have zero value, zero phone number, so the person is not having any phone number, or one or more. Right? I hope you must have understood the concept. So let's see now the another type of attribute. Those are known as the derived attributes. So what we mean by derived attributes? Derived means those are being obtained by making use of some other attribute. Say for example, let us assume that we are storing one attribute for instructor, and that is say date of birth, right? So date of birth is one of the attributes. Okay, obviously it is single valued attribute. Every person is obviously having a single value as date of birth, and that is why it is a single valued attribute. But if I'm having one more attribute, say age, for the same entity set, then age can be derived by making use of the attribute date of birth. So age is treated as the derived attributes. No need to input the value for age. It can be computed from other attributes. So if I'm having the attribute date of birth for my entity set, say instructor, and if I'm also having age as one more attribute in that entity set, then I may say that age is derived attribute, because age can be computed based on date of birth. Make sense? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I hope you must have understood these types of attributes. If you have any doubt, please let me know. Any doubts? Priyanka, roll number 357.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you understood the concept?
Yes, ma'am.
So will you please tell me what you have understood out of the concept of multi-valued attribute?
Ma'am, in multi-value attribute, we can store attribute in multi-value type, like phone number. The person may have multiple phone numbers.
Okay. Any other example for multi-valued attribute? Yes. Roll number 327. Sapna, roll number 327. Are you there, Sapna?
Yes.
Can you give me one example for multi-valued attribute other than phone number?
Email IDs.
Email IDs. So why it is multi-valued?
because one person have multiple email IDs.
Okay. Roll number 320.
Yes,
are you there? Can you give me one example other than name and address? Composite attribute. One example of composite attribute. Other than this name and address.
Date of birth can be classified as date, month and year.
Okay. So you would like to treat it as composite attribute?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the reason behind?
If we want to sort the salary of a person according to month, means when the person has joined the department, then we can calculate from the month wise.
Okay, that is a good thought process, but usually we do not treat day as composite attribute. And the reason is, whenever we go for implementation, we are having date as the data type, wherein we are going to store the dates. And whenever we are using date as the data type to store the dates, it is possible for us to manipulate those dates. And that is why we need not require to treat date as the composite attribute in practice. But it is a good thought process, right? But usually, date, we do not treat it as composite attribute. Okay, because we are having the functionalities to manipulate the dates in our database management systems, wherein we are practically going to use the implement that. Okay, fine. So I hope you must have understood the concepts. So may I proceed now? So I'm having here one example, instructor table with 4 attributes, ID, name, 5 attributes, ID, name, street, city, salary. So please tell me what kinds of attributes those are. What are the types of those attributes? I'll begin with roll number 323, Sakshi. Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
So what kind of attribute this ID is in instructor table? Yes.
It is simple.
Simple.
Attribute. No, single valued. Single valued. Single valued.
Single value. Okay, simple is also correct. Single valued is also correct. Roll number 325. Are you there? Roll number 325. Pratik.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So will you please tell me what kind of attribute name is?
Name is composite attribute, ma'am.
Composite attribute. What kind of attribute the city is? Yes.
City is also composite attribute.
Why?
Because city will have another city will also have street.
City will have
streets and city will street, also contain street. Some villages.
But street, no. We are talking about. We would like to store the values under those attributes. Na? So one person will reside in only one city.
Yes.
Right? So nothing like villages and anything like that. Street, we have mentioned as the separate attribute. So street is the separate attribute that we have mentioned.
Yes.
So city would be of what kind?
Simple attribute.
It is simple attribute. Okay. What about salary?
Salary is single value and simple attribute.
Okay. single value, simple attribute. Okay, what about street?
Street is composite attribute.
Okay, so we may treat street as composite attribute. Now, please tell me if I'm going to add one more attribute in this instructor table, right? And that attribute is age. Now tell me, what kind of attribute this age is?
Age is simple, simple single value attribute.
Yes, correct. Why?
Because we don't add here a date of birth. If we add date of birth, then it will be a derived attribute.
Okay, good. So I hope now everyone has understood the concepts. So let us proceed with next. So we are going to talk about now the relationship, right? So what we mean by a relationship? A relationship is actually an association among the entities. Relationship is association among several entities. What we mean by that? Let us look at these two entity sets. So we are having the entity set instructor and we are having entity set that is student. So in my instructor entity set, I am having several entities. Those relate to individual instructors, right? Similarly, in my student entity set, I am having several individual students. Those are individual entities. Do you agree with me? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, what we are going to define here is the relationship. So, if you look at the links those I have drawn, okay, in this figure, then I'm having a link that relates one instructor Crick with one student Tanaka, right? Also, I'm having the links. Those relate the instructor Cats with two students Shankar and Zan. Similarly, I'm having a link between the instructor Srinivasan and the student Brown. And so on, right? So, what actually I'm trying to show you, I'm trying to explain that here we are having some association between different entities. So, Crick is one entity, and this entity Crick is related with Tanaka. I'm having another entity that is Cats, and Cats is related with two entities, Shankar and Zan, right? So whatever is this association between entities, this association is called as the relationship. So Crick and Tanaka is having related. Cats is related with two students, Shankar and Zan. Srinivasan is related with one student, that is Brown, and so on. So, this is how we are relating several entities, right? So, this association among several entities is actually known as the relationship, right? So, here, I am having shown this relationship. So, towards left hand side, I am having student entity, and towards right hand side, I am having instructor entity. So, I am saying here that Cats, who is instructor, is related with Shankar, who is a student. And to denote this relation, right, I am having a relationship set. So, in between these two now, to denote such kinds of relationships, between instructors and students. I need to come up with the relationship set. So here we are denoting the relationship set, and we have provided the name to the relationship set as advisor. So I may say now that the instructor entity is related with student entity with the relationship set, that is advisor. So this advisor will store, this is a relationship set. It is collection now of relationships. So the relationships, individual relationships we have between instructor and student. So if I go on collecting all such relationships, then I'll be forming a relationship set and I'll be naming that relationship set. So in this situation, I'm naming this relationship set as advisor. So I may interpret this relationship like Katz is an advisor to the student Shankar. Katz is an advisor to the student Shankar. So similarly, I'm having the relations like Katz is an advisor to the student Zan. Crick is an advisor to student Tanaka. And this is how I'm having many such associations. I'm having many such relationships. And whenever I put all those relationships together, I'll say that I'm having one relationship set. So I'll be naming that relationship set as advisor, wherein I'm going to store now all these associations. Am I clear? Yes? Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
May I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, let us now formally define our relationship set. So, a relationship set is a set of relationships of the same type. What we mean by same type relationships? The relationship between instructor and student. So, these relationships are of same type. Right? So, relationship set is a set of relationships of the same type. So formally, we may say that it is a mathematical relation. Formally, we say that it is a mathematical relation on n equal to greater than or equal to two entities. So n number of entities. Okay? So if we are having a mathematical relation between two or more entities, each entity is taken from one of the entity sets, then we say that it is a relationship set. Let me formally give you the mathematical expression for that. Let us assume that we are having the entity sets, say E1, E2 up to EN. Right? N number of entity sets. Right? Then the relationship set R is a subset of E1, small E2 up to small EN, such that small E1 belongs to capital E1, small E2 belongs to capital E2, and small EN belongs to capital EN. Where we say that this group of attributes E1, E2 up to EN are the attributes. So this group of attributes forms a relationship. Let me give you, or let us relate this with our earlier example. What we are saying, capital E1, capital E2 up to capital EN are the entity sets. In our example, we had two entity sets. And which were these two entity sets? E1 and E2. We had instructor and student. So our E1 is instructor and our E2 is student. Right? So here my n, small n, is equal to 2 because we are talking about two entity sets. Right? So with respect to these two entity sets, we are having several attributes. Right? So in my relationship set R, right, I'll be having some subset of those attributes, such that one attribute, at least one attribute, I'm saying at least one. So one attribute is from E1 and another attribute is from E2. Right? So whenever I'm talking about this association, whenever I'm talking about this relationship between the entities, I'm defining it like the subset of the attributes from the entity sets. Those are participating. Okay? So E1 and E2 right now in my example, instructor and student. So while building this relationship, I'll be having one attribute from this E1 minimum and one attribute from this E2, and that will help me to explain the relationship between these two entities. For example, just we mentioned that this relationship set R is advisor in our example, right? So advisor is actually relating the entities from two entity sets, instructor and student, right? So I'm borrowing one attribute, or I'm depicting this relationship like ID of the instructor and ID of the student. So I may say that these two are related, ID of the instructor and ID of the student. So this is the attribute from my instructor table and this is the attribute from my student table. So I'm picking up the attributes, right? And whenever I'm having those attribute values associated with these IDs, then definitely what I can infer? I can infer that instructor with ID 44553 is related with the student having the ID 22222. Right? And this is one relationship in my relationship set advisor. Right? So this relationship belongs to my relationship set advisor. So similarly, I'm having several such relationships between the instructor and the student. And how I'm going to relate these two? I'm using the attributes from the respective entity sets. I'm using the attribute values from the respective entity sets. And then this will form my relationship. Are you getting me? If you have any doubts, please let me know. Any doubts? Yes. Any doubts so far? Roll number 330, Siddhi.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you understood the concept of relationship?
Yes, ma'am.
So, how will you explain relationship?
Relationship is an association between several entities. For example, if there is a student and there is an instructor, and they can be related as the instructor is the advisor of that given student, then the relationship set is the set of the relationship of a same type. And we can also define it by a mathematical relation in which for number of entities greater than or equal to 2, each of them can be taken from an entity set.
Okay. So.
So, if suppose E1, E2, E3, EN are some entity sets, then a relationship set R can be defined as a subset of E1, E2, up to EN, where E1 belongs to capital E1 and E2 belongs to capital E2.
So, what are the small E1, small E2?
They are the entities.
Small E1, small E2 are the attributes.
Attributes.
From those entity, respective entity sets. Okay. Right? So by making use of such attributes, actually we are trying to relate different entities from different entity sets. Right? And we are forming a relationship set. Okay. So I hope all of you have understood the concept. If you have any doubts, please let me know. Otherwise, we are going to move to the next concept. Okay? Now, we know the concept of relationship and relationship set. Right? Now, the association between entity sets is referred as the participation. What we mean by that? Say for example, if all those entity sets E1, E2 up to EN, right, are having contribution in some relationship, then we say that these entity sets E1, E2 up to EN participate in relationship set R. So in this mathematical example, n number of entity sets are participating in my relationship set R. Right? In our example of instructor and student, what we can say? We can say that my entity sets instructor and student are participating in relationship set advisor. So to have this advisor in existence, we need some entity sets to participate in that relationship. Right? So who are going to participate in relationship set advisor? Two entity sets. Who are these two entity sets? Instructor and student. Right? So this is a concept called as participation. So entity sets participate in a relationship set. So in our typical example, we may say that entity sets instructor and student participate in relationship set advisor. Am I clear? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let's proceed now with the few more concepts. As I mentioned earlier, attributes are actually the properties of entity sets. But now we are going to append this concept. We are going to add in. The attributes can also be the properties of relationship sets. I'll repeat. An attribute can also be a property of a relationship set. Now, what I mean by that? Let me give you one example. We have two entity sets, instructor and student. And we are having here depicted two attributes only from both the entity sets. So this is ID, which is attribute of my instructor. And this is instructor name, which is attribute of my entity set instructor. Similarly, for student, I am having two attributes here, ID and name. So these attributes are actually the properties of these entity sets. But what I'm saying now, I'm extending this concept. We may have attribute for our relationship set also. What we mean by that? We just mentioned that advisor is the relationship between instructor and student. Right? So by making use of that relationship, it is possible for us to know which instructor is advising which student. Right? Now, with this relationship, say advisor, if I want to associate one attribute, I want to store now. Let us assume, I want to store the date when that student has got that particular advisor. Or I want to store the starting date when this association has started. Then if I want to store that date, I need to have attribute for my relationship set advisor. Right? So my relationship set advisor will store both the IDs of instructor and student because they are related. Along with those IDs, my relationship set advisor will have the attribute date of association. Am I clear? So in a sense, it is possible to have the attribute for the relationship set. So in our example, our relationship set is advisor, right? And as we mentioned, we are having in advisor, we are having two attributes. In fact, ID of the instructor and ID of the student, because we would like to depict the association of these two entity sets, right? But along with these two attributes, it is possible for me to store few more data. So to store additional data, I need to have the attribute for the relationship set, and it is possible to have the attribute for the relationship set. So for my relationship set advisor, I may have the attribute that is date of association. So this date will tell me when a particular instructor has associated with a particular student. So by this, what I can understand, Crick is advising Tanaka, and this association between Crick and Tanaka has started on this date, 3rd of May. Correct? So this is, I'm going to store this information in the form of attribute with a relationship set. Any doubt? Have you understood the concept? Yes. Roll number 348, Karan. Roll number 348. Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you understood the concept?
Yes, ma'am.
So what you have understood, will you please explain?
Basically, relationship set is tells about the relationship between the entity sets. For example, here the attribute is a property of the relation set. The advisor is a relationship set in which the instructor and the students are related. So attribute can also be used for finding out the relationship between them. For example, one date can be used to identify when the instructor and student have started their conversation or have joined like that.
Yes, correct. Very good. Is there any doubt, anybody? So I hope you must have understood this concept, and let us proceed now with the next concept. And this concept is degree of a relationship set. Degree of a relationship set. So this degree of a relationship set refers to the number of entity sets that participate in a relationship set. I'll repeat. Degree of a relationship set refers to the number of entity sets that participate in the relationship set. So if n number of entity sets are participating in a particular relationship set, then we say that the degree of a relationship set is n. Usually, we prefer to have two entity sets, those are participating in relationship set. Say for example, if two entity sets are participating in the relationship set, we say that the degree of the relationship set is 2, or my relationship is binary. And generally, most of the relationship sets in our database system, we prefer to have the binary relationships where two entity sets are participating. Say for example, if once again we refer to our relationship set, that is advisor. How many entity sets are participating in this relationship set advisor? Yes? How many entity sets are participating in advisor relationship? Two. So advisor is my binary relationship because two entity sets, instructor and student, are participating in the relationship set advisor. So degree of advisor is 2, or I may say this is a binary relationship set. Am I clear? Any doubt? Yes. What is degree of relationship set? Roll number 342. Sahil.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you understood the concept of degree of the relationship set?
Yes, ma'am.
What it is?
Degree in relationship, that's that the number of entities that participate in a relationship set. For example, there is a n number of entity sets are in participate, then there is a n number of relationship set.
No, where if n entity sets are participating in the relationship set, then we say that degree of that relationship set is n.
N, yes.
If two entity sets are participating, then degree is 2. And typically, we say that this is a binary relationship set. And usually, we prefer to use binary relationship sets. There are the exceptions. If three entity sets are participating in the relationship set, then we say that it is a ternary relationship. If four entity sets are participating in one relationship set, then we say that it is quaternary relationship, right? So let me give you one example. So we have talked about the binary relationship, right? And that binary relationship, for example, we talked about the advisor, which is a binary relationship, wherein there are two entity sets participating, right? But as I mentioned, we may have more than two entity sets also. Those are participating in our relationship sets. So let me give you one example. students work on research projects under the guidance of an instructor. Students work on research projects under the guidance of an instructor. So I need to relate student entity set with the projects, and also I need to relate the instructor who is guiding to those students on the respective projects. So here I am having three entity sets: students, projects, and instructor. I'll repeat, I am having three entity sets: student, project, and instructor. And these three entity sets are participating. Right? These three entity sets are participating, right, in one relationship. We may name that relationship set, right? So this relationship set is ternary relationship set. What we mean by that? Because three entity sets are participating. So degree of this relationship set is three. Right? I hope you must have understood. We may name this relationship as project guide. And as I stated, we say that this project guide relationship set is ternary relationship set, because three different entity sets are participating: instructor, student, and project. I hope you must have understood, and this will define the degree of the relationship set, right? So relationships between more than two entity sets are rare. So sometimes we may have the relationships with the degree greater than two, but typically, as I mentioned, we prefer to use the binary relationships. Okay, we'll see later why we prefer to have binary relationships. Okay, but just remember now this concept of degree of a relationship set. I hope you must have understood the concept. Have you understood the concept? Any doubt so far? Any doubt so far? Yes. Any doubt? So let me summarize now the things those we have studied or we have discussed today. So what we discussed? We discussed about the relationship sets. Prior to that, we discussed about various types of attributes. We discussed about relationships and relationship sets. We discussed about the attributes for the relationship sets, right? We have seen the concept of participation. So entity sets participate in the relationships. We have seen the concept of degree of a relationship set. If you have any doubts related to all those concepts, please let me know. Okay, fine. So let's conclude today's session, and we are going to continue in our next session with few more concepts like constraints, right? We are going to talk about the constraints, the keys, and then we'll start drawing the ER model. So hopefully tomorrow we are going to discuss all those concepts, keys, the cardinalities or the constraints, and also hopefully we'll start drawing the ER models, right? So I would recommend those who are having the laptops or desktops available, you please try to install one software to draw the ER models, and that software is DIA, D-I-A. So try to install this software DIA, D-I-A. We are going to make use of this software DIA to draw the ER diagrams. Okay, so those who are having the laptops or desktops with you, please install this software. Okay, so let's conclude our session. Thank you.